knew I'd mess up it somewhere, so I got it out of the way. So. Next song we're going to sing is My Faith Has Found a Resting Place. It's one of my favorite, my wife and I's favorite hymns. And there's a phrase in the beginning that says, "Not in device nor creed," in the first verse. And I know that is not a familiar, it's not familiar words. Not in device nor creed. But I think we all understand that what it means is the same as the scripture verse that says, it's not by works, but by grace through faith that we are saved. It's not by anything that we do, no device, no method, no practice, but by simply trusting, not by a creed, not by keeping a set of laws or rules, but by simply trusting in Jesus. Listen to all the words of this song as we sing it. Let's sing it together. My faith has found a resting place. Powerful, powerful, simple, but powerful words. We fall down. We lay our crowns at the feet of Jesus. And we'll cry, "Holy, holy, holy is the Lamb." The song that I'm going to sing for you this morning is about just about that, about the grace of the one who took our place, the one who gave his life so that we could have life and have it eternally. Listen closely to the words, "Were it not for grace." Time measured out my days. Life carried me along. In my soul I yearned to follow God, but knew I'd never be so strong. I looked hard at this world. to learn how heaven could be gained, just to end where I began, where human effort is all in vain. Were it not for grace, I can tell you where I'd be, wandering down some pointless road to nowhere, with my salvation up to me, and I know how that would go. Battles I would face, forever running but losing the race, were it not for grace. So here is all my praise, expressed with all my heart, offered to the friend who took my place and ran the course I couldn't even start. And when he saw in full just how much his love would cost, he still went the final mile between me and heaven, so I would not be lost. Were it not for grace, I can tell you where I'd be, wandering down some pointless road to nowhere, with my salvation up to me, and I know how that would go. The battles I would forever running but losing the race, were it not for grace. Sing it with us. Grace, grace, God's grace, grace that will part down some pointless road to nowhere, with my salvation up to me, and I know how that would go. The battles I would face, forever race, were it not for grace, forever running, losing the race.
Praise the Lord. Thank you, Richard. Thank you, Lord, for your grace. How beautiful. Thank you, choir. Let me invite you to open your Bibles to the Gospel of Matthew, Matthew chapter 8, and we're going to be looking at verses 28 through 32. Brother Ted read this passage earlier in our service, so I will not read it again. We'll look at it more carefully as we go through it. Let's go to the Lord together for a word of prayer. Our Father, we love you today. We thank you for what we've already experienced. Lord, you are here in our very presence. And we give you our thanksgiving. We give you our worship for who you are and for what you do. And God, we pray that you would have your way with our lives here today. We thank you, Lord, for your perfect word. We ask your blessings upon the reading of it, and the preaching of it, and the hearing of it. And we ask in the name of Jesus. Amen. Baseball is typically not a confrontational sport, but sometimes it is. Sometimes confrontations happen between players, and sometimes between coaches and umpires, and sometimes between players and umpires. Maybe the most famous confrontation between a player and an umpire happened between Babe Pinelli and Babe Ruth. Babe Pinelli, the umpire, called Babe Ruth, the home run king, out on strikes. Babe Ruth turned around and said, "There are 40,000 people here that know that that last pitch was a ball, tomato head." Babe Pinelli answered, "Maybe so, but my opinion is the only opinion that matters." In baseball, that's true. The only opinion that matters is the opinion of the umpire. This passage of Scripture, we're not going to get through with it all, really. It goes through verse 34. We just don't have time. There's just too much in it. So today we're going to go through verse 32, and then on June 26th, we're going to come back and we're going to finish this passage of Scripture. This passage is about confrontation. And in it we learn simply, the only opinion that matters is the opinion of Jesus the Christ, God Almighty. His is the only opinion that matters. So last time we were in Matthew, we saw Jesus' power over nature. This morning we're going to see a different confrontation of power. We're going to see that Jesus confirmed his authority over the dark powers of Satan and his army of demons. But what can we learn about confrontation from this passage about Jesus casting demons into swine? We're going to look at three confrontations this morning and two next time that will help us understand the power of God in our lives. First of all, let's look at demons and us. Demons and us. Look at verse 28. Matthew 8:28. I'm reading from the New King James Version, so the words are a little different from the NIV. The Bible says, "When he had come to the other side, to the country of the Gergesenes, there met him two demon-possessed men coming out of the tombs, exceedingly fierce, so that no one could pass that way." Now, last time we were in Matthew, we saw that Jesus and his disciples left Capernaum to go to the other side of the Sea of Galilee. And on their way, they encountered a fierce storm. And you'll remember the disciples panicked while Jesus slept. Then Jesus arose and he rebuked the wind and he ordered the sea to be still, and there was a great calm. It went from a class 5 hurricane to waters as still as glass. We said that Jesus was teaching his disciples something about faith. And as a result of having Jesus in their boat in the midst of the storm, they took a fresh new look at who this Jesus really is. Matthew 8:27 says, "So the men marveled, saying, 'Who can this be that even the winds and the sea obey him?'" So now we find in our passage that they reached the other side. They landed in the country of the Gergesenes, or the Gadarenes, according to Mark and Luke, and according to the NIV. It's interesting. We don't know a great deal about the Gergesenes, except that this area was part of the larger area known as Decapolis, which we'll look at next time on the 26th. One thing we know is this was Gentile country, well known to be Gentile country. Now, the story is also told in Mark's gospel and in Luke's gospel. Matthew devotes less time, less verses, fewer verses than does either Mark or Luke. Mark, who's typically the briefest of the gospel writers, devotes the most verses to this particular story. He devotes 20 verses. Luke 14, Matthew only 7. But Matthew tells us something that neither Mark nor Luke told us. Matthew says there were two demon-possessed men in that cemetery. Mark and Luke only mention one. But Bible scholars are quick to point out that Mark and Luke probably told the story from the point of view of the more vocal of the two demon-possessed men. So this is not a problem biblically nor theologically. Matthew is simply telling us that there were two demon-possessed men there. And Matthew is very brief in his story. He tells us that these men were exceedingly fierce so that no one could pass that way. Now, Matthew could afford to be brief because of the word that he chose here to use for fierce. This is an unusual word. It's a rare word. It's only used twice in all the Bible. Here, and in 2 Timothy chapter 3 and verse 1. The word literally means dangerous. In 2 Timothy 3:1, it's translated perilous. These demon-possessed men were very, very dangerous men. They were a serious, credible threat. Now, Mark and Luke chose not to use this word, so they gave a more detailed description of just how fierce this man was, or these men were. Mark tells us they cut themselves with stones. Luke tells us they were naked. They were under the control of demons for a long time. All three gospel writers tell us they were living among the tombs. They were living in a cemetery. Clearly, the point is, these demons had absolutely destroyed these men's lives. As a matter of fact, when you look at all three of the gospel accounts, it sounds much more like a description of animals than it does of men. But these weren't animals. These were two men created in the image of God, men of infinite value to God, men for whom Jesus Christ was about to go to the cross and die for their souls. They weren't animals. They were men created in the image of God, men of infinite value to God. And these demons had perverted this image of God and twisted these men into a pitiful, sickening sight. We're not told what led to their demon possession. Maybe they'd been dabbling in Satan worship. Or maybe they had just gotten so involved in sin, so caught up in sin, that eventually sin just took over their lives and destroyed them. You see, these men weren't sick. They were not insane. These were demon-possessed men. They were possessed by evil entities that sought more than anything else to destroy their lives. And these men were no match for the demons. So these demons had their way with these men. It was demons versus men, and the men were no match. Well, secondly, let's look at demons and society. Look at verse 28 again. I want us to focus this time on the last part of the verse, that last phrase. Look at Matthew 8:28. "And when he had come to the other side of the country of the Gergesenes, there met him two demon-possessed men coming out of the tombs, exceedingly fierce, look, so that no one could pass that way." The second confrontation we see in this passage is between society and these two demon-possessed men. These men were violent and they were dangerous. They were out of control. Luke 8 in verse 27 tells us they were from the city. That means at one time, what? They were functioning members of society. They were born to mothers who loved them. Probably just like you and probably just like me. They may have had families. Men of great value to God. And these demons had invaded their souls and twisted them, perverted God's design and God's purpose for their lives. And society tried to help them. Well, no, they didn't. No, they didn't. Society tried to help itself. Society tried to protect itself from these men. But the men broke the chains. Mark 5:3 says, no one could bind them. Matthew 8:28 says, no one could pass that way. So society did the next best thing. They took them out of the town, down to the cemetery, and chained them up there. They broke those chains too, by the way. Check out the accounts in Mark and Luke, and you'll find that. They took them down to the cemetery so that they could simply avoid that part of the town. For all intents and purposes, as far as society was concerned, their problem was solved. These demon-possessed men were out of town. They were in the tombs. They were in the cemetery. You see, it didn't solve the men's problem. And it really didn't solve society's problem either. Because what? Because there was always the threat they could come back. They had broken the chains. No one could bind them. What was to keep them from coming back to the city? You see, they did what we do. They tried to solve a spiritual problem by physical means. Now listen. Our nation is filled with prisons. And don't get me wrong, we need prisons. I'm not preaching do away with all the prisons. But by the way, while I'm on it, I'll preach this. Read up about, is it Angola prison? Blue saying, I don't know. I think it's Angola prison in Louisiana, where men and women are being saved like nowhere else. And they're leaving prison and they're starting churches. Their lives are being changed. Awesome. As a matter of fact, we're going to hear about them at the convention this year. I can't wait to hear it. It's a ministry from New Orleans Seminary, my alma mater. I'm proud of the work that the Lord's doing there through that seminary in that prison. I'm not saying that we should do away with prisons. That's what we do. We take people and we put them away. We put them away to get them out of ourselves, to get them away from us, to make ourselves feel better. to make ourselves feel safer. And people living in prisons in our nation, in our state, there are people whose lives have been destroyed by Satan and by his demons. Listen, and you know this, we've already talked about it today. God loves you, and he loves me. You talk about grace, you talk about the love of God. God loves us with a perfect love. There is nothing we could ever do to make God stop loving us. Think about that. No one in the history of the world could ever do anything to make God stop loving them. God loves us with a perfect love. Now understand, Satan and his demons hate us that much. They hate us with a perfect hatred. So the people in the city did what we too often do. You see, we put people like that away because that makes us feel safer. But we're really not safe, are we? Because they could always get out and come back to where we are. We are a security-minded people. We pay for security. You just watch television. You just notice how many commercials there are on television about security. There's more advertising about security than probably any other thing. We buy security for our health, for our automobiles, for our homes, for our businesses, for our money. I didn't buy enough security for my computer because I got a virus last week. We buy security for everything. National security is a primary concern for us. We have whole divisions of our government dedicated for security. We have Homeland Security, the Security Exchange Commission. We have local security, state security, national security. We are a society that craves security, but what? We're never satisfied. We can never get enough. And we're a people willing to pay anything for it, any price. But we never have peace. We're a nation chock full of security, probably the most secure nation on the face of the earth, yet we must be the most insecure nation on the face of the earth because we want more and more and more and more security. We want security. We want to be safe. Really, that's all we want. And we can only find it in Jesus Christ. He's the only place we can find it. The Bible contains many references to demon possession. In fact, Jesus has already dealt with it in Matthew's gospel. And he's going to deal with it a lot more before the gospel of Matthew comes to an end. So we need to take a minute or two to talk about it. You see, we think of demon possession, typically we think of demon possession of something that happened a long, long time ago in biblical times. Something that might happen now, but only in very rare circumstances. What we don't seem to realize is that Satan is just as much at work now as he's ever been in the world. But his work today, at least in America, is much more subtle. But I got news for you, folks. A thief is a thief. A thief is a thief. And Jesus called Satan a thief. John 10, verse 10, the thief does not come except to steal and to kill and to destroy. And Jesus went on, I have come that they may have life and they may have it more abundantly. You see, in our day, Satan's most effective tool, or at least one of his most effective tools for stealing, killing, and destroying lives are drugs and alcohol. Just are. That's just the truth. Talking about prisons, our prisons are filled with people whose lives have been destroyed by drugs and alcohol. Let's compare the effects. with demon possession. Look at the men in this passage. The demons stole their dignity. The demons destroyed their marriages and their families if they had one. The demons would have eventually killed them both. What does drugs and alcohol do to people? Destroys their dignity. Destroys marriages and families. And it eventually kills its victims. You see, the manifestation of evil may have changed, but the results are very much the same. And I want you to listen very carefully. Results are all that Satan is interested in. He doesn't care how he gets us or how he gets our eyes off of Jesus. He's just interested in results. And society is powerless against Satan. And it's powerless because it's blind to the problem. You see, society saw two crazy men who posed a danger to them. Society saw the physical effects of a spiritual problem. And until we realize that we can't solve a spiritual problem with a physical solution, we're going to remain a hurting and a frightened and an insecure society. Well, thirdly, let's look at Jesus and demons. This shouldn't take very long. But let's look at verses 29 through 32. And suddenly they cried out, saying, "What have we to do with you, Jesus, you Son of God? Have you come here to torment us before the time?" Now a good way off from them, there was a herd of many swine feeding. So the demons begged him, saying, "If you cast us out, permit us to go away into the herd of swine." And he said to them, "Go." So when they had come out, they went into the herd of swine, and suddenly the whole herd of swine ran violently down the steep place into the sea and perished in the water. This third confrontation we see in this passage cuts to the very root of the problem. The men couldn't fix their problem on their own, so they were hopeless. They were helpless. Society couldn't fix their problem. They just treated the symptom. But Jesus knew exactly what was going on. Jesus knew exactly who to blame. He understood the source of the problem. Interestingly, you can check this out. Mark gives us the initial response of these two demon-possessed men. What do you think they did? They ran and they worshiped Jesus. But look what the demon said. "What have we to do with you, Jesus, you Son of God? Have you come here to torment us before the time?" First of all, there's a lot in this. First of all, did you know that in the Gospel of Matthew, no human being spoke to Jesus with more reverence and more truth than these demons? In Mark's Gospel, they called him the Most High God. There's not a higher title attributed to the Lord Jesus Christ in the New Testament than that one. And it was given by demons from hell. Are you kidding me? Demons attribute more authority, more respect to Jesus Christ than most people do? No wonder we live in such an insecure world. No wonder. Demons have an abundance of faith in Jesus Christ. They just don't have saving faith. But they know who He is. James 2:19 says, "You believe there is one God, you do well. Even the demons believe and tremble." But notice what these demons did. They went on the immediate defensive. They asked Jesus if He had come to torment them before the time. Now, Matthew is the only one of the gospel writers that includes that little phrase, "before the time." The demons were implying that Jesus not, so they were begging Him not to send them to hell before the time of the final judgment. They were begging Him for what we sometimes beg Him for: give us a little more time. They were bargaining, they were begging for their freedom. because they knew that Jesus Christ had the authority to send them right then and right there to the very pit of hell. And they didn't want to go. You want to know how bad hell is? Even the demons don't want to go there. They were begging for a little more time away from hell. Did you know that in the Gospels, Jesus never sent demons to hell? You can read that on your own. He just sent them out of people because their time for eternal confinement had not yet come or has not yet come. And until that time, they will seek to steal and to kill and destroy the lives of people. People just like you and people just like me. And according to the Gospel of Matthew, Jesus lit a bunch of candles and set in for a 2-day exorcism ritual? No. According to the Gospel of Matthew, Jesus gave a one-word answer, go. And there you have it, deviled hell. Laughter sign. You're supposed to laugh. That was the joke. Water break. These demons, they did to the pigs what they wanted so desperately to do with these men. And by the way, with us, they destroyed them all. You see, people are no match for demons. Society is no match for demons. But Satan and his army of demons is no match for Jesus. And it's only in the name of Jesus Christ that we can have security. Eternal security. There is no security, any security, apart from a personal faith relationship with Jesus the Christ. And I hope and I pray that you will place your trust in Jesus the Christ, my Savior and my Lord, today. Let's go to the Lord together for prayer. Father, we love you. We've come here today for the purpose of worshiping you. Our minds are fixed upon Jesus Christ, upon his saving power, upon his awesome authority. We see it so clearly in these scriptures. Holy Spirit, have your way with our lives. Some of us here today have never been saved. Some of us are saved, but we're not living like it. God, open our eyes to the truth that we can respond. For it's in Jesus' name we pray. Amen. If there's never been a time in your life when you prayed to receive Jesus Christ as your personal Savior and Lord, we want you to give your life to Jesus today. That will simply be the smartest thing you ever did in your life. That's the most important decision anyone can ever possibly make. Maybe you've made such a commitment to Christ, but you've never been baptized. You've never made a public profession of your faith. You need to come. Maybe God is calling you to rededicate your life to the Lord Jesus Christ. You need to come. Maybe he's calling you to join this church. However he's calling, we need to be honest. We just saw how much power and how much authority Jesus has. He can calm storms with the word. He can control all of the demons and all of hell with a word. He has that much power. Let's submit our lives to him today. Richard, come and lead us in an invitation hymn.